Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome. Before we go any further, we would just like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we're standing, the Ngunnawal people. We pay our respects to elders past, present, and emerging, and we also particularly welcome Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people who are participating with us today. Today's webinar is about the COVID Unmasked survey and what it reveals about mental health impacts of COVID-19 on young children and their carers. COVID-19 Unmasked is an online study that was launched in Australia in May 2020 to advance urgent research into understanding the mental health impacts of the pandemic on children aged 1 to 5 and their families. 8 other countries have joined the global collaboration. And to date, over 1,000 Australian families have participated in the survey. And today, Dr. Alex D. Young will talk to us about what's been learned from the survey and implications and recommendations for clinical practice. And a little bit about Alex. Alex is a clinical psychologist and research fellow at the Queensland Centre for Perinatal and Infant Mental Health, Children's Health Queensland, and the University of Queensland. She is internationally recognised as a leading expert in the diagnosis, assessment, prevention, and early intervention for PTSD following medical trauma during early childhood. She has also been involved in the development of the award-winning Birdie's Tree resources that support the mental health and wellbeing of young children and families affected by disruptive events. And of course, she is currently leading the COVID-19 Unmasked Global Collaboration, which is what she's here to speak with us all about today. Welcome, Alex, and thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you very much, Paul, for the introduction and to Eracy for the opportunity to be part of this webinar today. It's really exciting to be able to share some of the findings that we've been having coming out of this research over the last 12 months or so. So as Paul gave the background for me, I am a clinical psychologist and have spent the majority of my time doing research with very young children after medical trauma. And that's where I've really developed my passion, I suppose, with trying to understand the impacts of disruptive or stressful events during these early years. And then in recent years, I've been working with the strategy team at the Queensland Centre for Perinatal and Infant Mental Health, which is a statewide service in Queensland, where we develop and deliver services across the continuum of mental health care. I'm also a mother of 3 young boys, and during the pandemic, at the time of the peak of it all, there were 3, 5 and 7. So it was very interesting looking along the way at understanding and thinking about what is my 3-year-old, 5-year-old and 7-year-old showing during these times. And that's really helped to inform some of the understanding and things moving forward as well. So before I get probably started in the presentation, I would also like to do an acknowledgement of country. So I'd like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land on which I'm presenting today, which is the Turrbal and Yuggera people, as well as the lands and throughout Australia where everyone is joining us today. I'd like to pay my respects to the elders past, present and emerging. I'd also like to give a recognition of lived experience and value and respect the involvement of families who are impacted by the lived experience of mental health, and particularly for those families who have participated during a particularly stressful and challenging time over these last 12 months. Without your involvement, we wouldn't know how to really understand and move forward from the findings of our research. So just a brief overview of what I'm planning on covering today in the webinar. Just a brief overview of what is infant and early childhood mental health, then introducing the background around COVID-19 Unmasked and the global collaboration that has started since we launched in Australia. So the main focus today will be talking about the impact that the pandemic has been having on Australian children aged 1 to 5 years and their caregivers, as well as some of the early risk and protective factors that we've seen in the early stages of the pandemic. And then briefly going over, well, what are the implications and recommendations for clinical practice based on the findings to date from this research? Okay, so I've always liked this figure as a way of helping understand mental health. So many of you are probably familiar with this mental health spectrum. And we know that it does occur on a continuum, and this is from infancy through to adults. And so what I really want to focus on today is thinking about, well, what does healthy mental health look like in very young children, and also what might be the signs of the unwell and struggling. So infant and early childhood mental health is defined as the developing capacity to be able to form close and secure relationships, particularly with their caregivers, as well as with their siblings, other family members and friends over time. It's also about their emerging ability to be able to experience, express and manage a range of different types of emotions. It's also showing signs of interest in exploring, curiosity of things that are going on around them in the environment, as well as the ability to show persistence, sustain engagement and effort in a range of challenging activities. And finally, also having the ability to respond and adapt to different changes, demands and expectations in the environment around them. What we know less about is the impact of mental ill health in this age group. And one of the big reasons for this is it's been largely assumed that children under the age of six, particularly babies, do not experience mental health difficulties. There's also been a lot of stigma around giving the diagnosis of a mental health disorder to a young child, but also limited diagnostic assessment tools and self-report measures from parents, making it particularly challenging to really understand how it presents in this age group. Fortunately, there are growing numbers of studies in these areas. And so a really great meta-analysis by one of my colleagues, Mira Vasileva, looked at 10 epidemiological studies from around the world to look at the prevalence of mental health disorders. And so what they found is that babies and young children, so 1 to 5 years of age, can and do develop mental health disorders. So around 20% of young children did have a mental health disorder, and around 6.4% had comorbidity with one or more disorders occurring. And these rates are reported to be comparable to what is seen in older children and adolescents. So the most common disorders that were found were oppositional defiant disorder, so around 5%, and then anxiety disorders, particularly specific phobias, with around 3% of children in this study, this meta-analysis, and around 1.9% with separation anxiety, and a 0.2% prevalence for PTSD. Now, I just wanted to introduce these numbers just to give some context around pre-pandemic numbers of mental health disorders that are seen around the world. So early last year, my team had actually submitted some funding as we wanted to do some research to help us understand the impacts of the devastating 2019-2020 bushfires. Unfortunately, the funding application wasn't successful, but what it meant was when we quickly realised the emerging pandemic and potential impacts on young children, we decided to adapt the proposed research to an online study to help us understand the impact of the pandemic over a 12-month period for very young children, as well as hopefully follow up and track some of the young children who've been through some of the recent Australian bushfires and floods. And so the aim of this survey is to understand how the pandemic is affecting families, and so both the positive and the negative experiences. We're also interested in understanding the social and emotional well-being for very young children aged 1 to 5 years. Understanding again how this is impacting on their parents and their parenting style. When I say parents, I'm also referring to caregivers in general, so I might use that term interchangeably. And also identifying what are the risk and protective factors for good as well as poor mental health outcomes during the course of the pandemic. So after we started pulling this study together in Australia, one of my colleagues, Megan Marzak in the US, expressed some interest in collaborating on this project. And things quickly escalated from there, I guess. So some other colleagues who are part of the Global Collaboration on Traumatic Stress Studies suggested that we list our project on their website along with 9 or so other global collaboration projects happening around the world. So what happened is when we advertised the project in saying that we were interested in anyone who wanted to collaborate in any way. We had a number of researchers from other ones throughout US, the UK, Netherlands, Poland, Spain, Greece and Cyprus and Turkey have all joined this collaboration. So from the Australian side of things, I would just like to acknowledge my collaborators, Mira Vasileva, Sonia March, Rebecca Patterson, Eva Alasic, Elizabeth Hohen, Vanessa Cobham, Christelle Middledorp, Caroline Donovan, and Talia Gash. So these colleagues are from Children's South Queensland, the University of Queensland, USQ, University of Melbourne, and Griffith University. Oh, and I should say, as part of this global collaboration, what the Australian team has done is we've shared our ethics applications, the study protocols, all of the measures and the Red Cap online platform that we're using to help facilitate the other teams setting up their projects. Each study is responsible for obtaining their own ethics approvals and then setting up the surveys in the various online platforms that each country has access to. And the plan is that once all of the teams have finished collecting the data, that we will combine it into one large open access data set to then look at joint collaborations to really understand how the pandemic is affecting young children across the world. So just to refresh everyone on the pandemic timeline and how our survey fits within some of the key parts over the last 12 months or so. So in March, early March was when the first cases of community transmission started happening, and quickly things escalated with around end of March when the closures of clubs, restaurants, schools and early childcare centres started happening, and when people started working more from home. During July, during April was when we started seeing the flattening of curve and some things started returning to some type of normality and a few more freedoms coming back. So May 12 was when our COVID-19 Unmasked survey was launched in Australia. Then during June to July was when Melbourne started having some of the hotspots and the start of the lockdown started, with August being the month where a state of disaster was declared. This then co-occurred with the second survey or the three-month follow-up for COVID Unmasked happening in Australia. During October is when some of those Melbourne restrictions eased, and then our third survey began in November last year. And then, of course, there's been several shorter lockdowns that have been experienced in various states in the following months that have been happening. Okay, so as I've touched on, there's several time points that we're doing this survey. So it's a prospective longitudinal study where the baseline occurs from whenever the countries were able to get their study started. So in Australia, that was May to June. We then follow up at 3, 6, and 12 months. And we're also now aiming to hopefully follow families up at one additional time point at 24 months. So the participants are caregivers of children aged 1 to 5 years. And the survey is completed on Red Cap, which for people not familiar, it's an online platform such as similar to Qualtrics or SurveyMonkey. So there's a number of measures that we developed specifically for the unique nature of the pandemic. So this includes the pandemic exposure and impact questionnaire, and we put this together to try and understand some of the direct COVID exposures that Australian families may be having. So whether the child was diagnosed with COVID, whether they lost any loved ones, as well as wanting to understand the indirect impacts it's having on daily lives, as well as some of the positive experiences. So the Promise Early Childhood is a patient-reported outcome measure. It's a very new measure that was released, the development paper was launched just as I was starting this survey. And I was quite excited to find this, as there's such a limited number of empirically validated assessment tools that are appropriate for the early years. So this measure allows us to assess a global mental health measure, as well as the scales of understanding irritability and anger, anxiety, depressive symptoms, sleep disturbance, positive affect, emotion regulation, and parent-child relationships. And there's a normative sample, which is a US sample, and it can tell us whether children are falling within normal limits or 1 to 2 standard deviations above this normative population. So I'll go into more detail when we get to that section then. We also specifically developed the PTSD scale for young children to help us track the number of prior traumas that children may have experienced, such as the bushfires or medical trauma, as well as exposure to traumatic events during the course of the pandemic. So one of the things we're interested in tracking or seeing if there's any increased exposure to domestic violence over this time. My colleague Mira Vasileva, as part of her postdoc work, has developed the preschooler stress-related thoughts and worries questionnaire to help us really try to understand what does worry look like, or is it possible for a 3 to 5 year old to express worries. The Depression Anxiety Stress Scale 21 is the outcome measure we're using to track parents' mental health. And the parenting as a social context is a validated tool to help, and we're using the warmth and rejection scales to assess parenting approaches during the pandemic. So the demographics for all of the families who've signed up to participate at Survey 1, so there was a total of 988 families who commenced the survey and completed some of the measures. So we have even numbers of boys and girls in our sample, with the majority of children falling within the 3 to 5 year age range, with a mean age of 3.7 years. Around 6% of children in our sample have a history of chronic health conditions. Around 3% have a history of sensory or physical disorders or a prior emotional mental health difficulty that's been reported to the parent or notice of concern by a health professional. And around 2% of families or parents reported that they have had a history of relationship difficulties with their child. As is expected for surveys, unfortunately, the majority of caregivers are mothers with a mean age of 35 years. And this sample is overrepresented by caregivers who are tertiary educated with mid to high levels of family income. And the majority of caregivers are still married. Of note, around 25% reported that themselves or a household member were considered to be vulnerable to COVID-19. In terms of locations of where our families came from throughout Australia, so the majority were from major cities of Australia, with only 5% coming from outer regional Australia, less than 1% from remote Australia. The majority of our participants came from Queensland, so 46%, followed by Victoria with around 23%, and New South Wales. Unfortunately, no participants from the Northern Territory. In terms of the direct exposures, so this number of 27,000, that was just to give an idea of at the time this survey was completed, this was how many total cases in Australia there were. So we've had no children at the start of the survey diagnosed with COVID-19, and one parent or caregiver was. Only 2% have lost a loved one as a result of COVID-19, with around 10% losing a loved one from another cause. So what we found, are finding though, is even though there were, compared to, I guess, other countries, less direct exposure or threat from catching COVID-19, there's been many indirect impacts on daily living that are having ongoing effects that I will go into more as well later. But what is important to think about is what might be stressful for an older child or adult can be quite different for a very young child. And so what we're seeing is the biggest impact for this age group is not being able to see family and friends. And this is particularly the case of grandparents, who play such a significant role in many young children's lives and a great support for parents as well. And so we found that around 77% of parents reported that their child was moderate to very much impacted by not seeing family and friends, and nearly 60% were impacted by changes in routines. So the big things were not being able to go to childcare anymore, or having to adjust to their parents working from home and not being able to interact with them in ways they would normally be able to, or not being able to go to their favourite park and not understanding why they couldn't do that. And of course, things like birthday parties are very important events for a young child. And so many parents gave lots of examples of parents being children being upset by missing out or not understanding why they couldn't do the things they wanted to do. I think this quote sums up some of the impacts in terms of, when do I get to see grandma? It's not fair. Don't they want to see me anymore? In terms of for caregivers and parents, obviously there's been some significant impacts on daily living as well. The biggest things reported by parents was feeling isolated, lonely and trapped. I mean, these are significant risk factors for mental health. Around 20 to 30% have reported increased tension or disconnection from their child or their partner. Of concern, up to 7% were reporting new or increased exposure to family violence. Around 15% of families had reported difficulties getting access to essential things such as medication, food, or not being able to attend therapy sessions or other medical appointments that they were previously able to attend. So some of the quotes from parents are, as a single parent family, this has been a stressful time, mainly due to the isolation and loss of our support systems. Or, we're still together, however, this time has strained our relationship. And juggling work and homeschooling is very stressful if you want to do a decent job of both. High expectations from both workplaces and schools amplified this situation. Friends and family all felt the same, failing at both. Okay, so moving on to some of the common responses that we've seen coming out of the survey. So the main things, the most common things reported were increased sadness in the children, increased clinginess or separation anxiety, that the child was going backwards in previously developed skills, such as bedwetting or toileting accidents during the day, taking longer to fall asleep or waking up more during the night, having increased emotional outbursts or temper tantrums, or talking about new or increased fears and worries. So during survey one, completed in May to June last year, overall, based on the PROMIS outcome measure, we found that 1 in 5 children are experiencing mild to moderate levels of emotional and behavioural difficulties, with around 5 up to 10% of children having very high levels that may be in indication of the need for specialised infant mental health support. So taking a closer look at the outcomes on the PROMIS, so the areas in green indicate the children who are falling within normal limits on this measure. The yellow section is for children who are falling one standard deviation above their mean, the score of 50, a T-score of 50, and very high is for children 2 standard deviations or more above. So what we found is that around 5% of children were showing very high levels of anger and irritability, and around 1 in 4 or 22% of children were experiencing higher than average levels of anxiety, depressive symptoms and sleeping changes. Now, just to show you for comparison, some of my colleagues, led by Sonia March, have also been doing a survey with school-aged children and adolescents, so between 6 to 17 years of age. And so this figure here is just showing the first two areas are for the ARCADs. So for the number of children falling in the borderline or clinical ranges. So with the older children, 13 to 16% were in the clinical range for depression and anxiety. And on the strengths and difficulties questionnaire for these, I'm not sure if you can see my arrow, but for the remaining 4 columns, around 16, 18% of children are showing hyperactivity or conduct problems, and 32% were having emotional problems in the elevated ranges. So one of the things that I found really interesting is exploring what type of what worries or understandings that the preschool age children, so 3 to 5 year olds in our subsample, what types of things are they showing? Often again, it's assumed that this age group don't worry, and it's certainly different to older children, but parents provided some quite remarkable examples of this during this time. What we found is that most children did overall understand some of the things that were going on, but many also had lots of confusion and misunderstandings about the cause of COVID-19 or the perceived threat of actually catching the virus. Parents reported that young children were expressing their worries through conversation, so talking about those worries, or it was through the drawings that they were doing, or by the play and playing out scenes related to other kids catching coronavirus or things like that. And I've touched on some of the behavioural and emotional changes, but particularly clinginess, regression, and increased tantrums. So some of the examples parents gave us were her worry tummy has been present more often. A four-year-old girl was reported to say, everyone going out will get the virus, people going out are all naughty, and the police will get them. A three-year-old boy was concerned that the koalas might get coronavirus and die. I think that's a reflection of some of the concerns that were going around the bushfires at the start of the year. Another five-year-old was said more recently she had a big breakdown when she cried and cried that everything is gone. There's no school, no park, no friends. There's only the shops and bushwalking, and kids can't even go to the shops. And then finally, this is a drawing from a three-year-old boy who said, I'm a superhero fighting the coronavirus with punches, fire, ice and lasers. Now it's dead. I'm also going to throw it to the sharks to eat. I think this is the shark down here, and I'll get you and make you gone. As I mentioned earlier on, I'm particularly interested in the impact of trauma during early childhood. So what we found was that around 1 in 10 children, or 8.6%, were reported by their parents who experienced a potentially traumatic event prior to or during the start of the pandemic. So of the children who had, the diagram, we can see that the majority of children in this sample, so 43%, had experienced a medical trauma. And there was around 20% of children who had experienced a previous natural disaster, including the bushfires or some flooding. And around 5% had experienced physical, emotional, or sexual abuse. So of the children who had experienced a prior trauma, 33% were reported to be experiencing symptoms that were interfering with their relationships, their everyday activities, and their routines. And there was 17% who were presenting with a pattern of symptoms and in a level of impairment that would be consistent with a probable possible PTSD diagnosis. Just a quote from a parent, we had the bushfire come right up to our house. We weren't allowed home for 2 days until we were safe. We had to keep running from the fire to safety. Poor thing had no idea what was happening, but she was so scared. So looking at some of the risk and protective factors for children who were scoring, having high scores on the PROMIS scales, we found that children where parents were reporting that they were able to stick to or maintain or create new routines or had a warm, responsive caregiving style or were regularly doing things outside of the home and showing less confusion about COVID-19 in the pandemic, had lower levels of emotional behavioural difficulties. However, we found that children who had more frequent exposure to COVID-19 information, so such as viewing it on the TV, with parents reporting higher levels of worry about the impact of COVID-19, of course, if parents were experiencing their own mental health difficulties, or if they were showing avoidant or overprotective parenting, so avoidant might be avoiding talking about the pandemic altogether with their children, or reported parent-child relationship difficulties, these children were showing a less emotional, positive emotional well-being during the early stages of the pandemic. In terms of parent outcomes from that first survey, we found that one in five parents on the DAS were reporting moderate to extremely severe levels of depression, anxiety, and stress. So the most common and frequent worries for parents were their ability to successfully juggle multiple demands, worrying about their child's social and emotional learning needs, as well as the mental health and well-being of their family members and friends. There was around 20 to 30% who were worried, very worried about themselves or their family getting sick or dying from COVID-19. So some of the risk factors for poor parent mental health during this time. So parents who had higher levels were also reporting an increase in emotional or physical violence. And the family, other parents are reporting a loss of social support, increased feelings of isolation or feeling lonely. And as well as parents who are identifying as Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander. Whereas a protective factor appears to be parents who are reporting more positive experiences during the early stages of the pandemic. So now what I'd like to do is to move on to the findings that we found from our second survey. And because this survey was completed just after the first lockdown, and then during the second lockdown by families who went through it in Victoria, we were able to clearly compare the two groups of participants, which has been really interesting, which I'll go into now. So to begin with, I'm now presenting the resilience subscales. So we're defining resilience by the positive affect, positive family relationships and emotion regulation scales from the PROMIS. So higher scores on these subscales indicate higher levels of resilience or emotional well-being. So we had around 204 families in this group who did not experience the second extended lockdown, so outside of Victoria. So overall, the promising news is that the majority of young children are showing positive signs of emotional well-being and resilience. So particularly 88% with positive emotions and experiences and the ability to regulate strong emotions. What we can see in comparison is there's around 100 families who completed the survey who did go through the second lockdown in Victoria. And what you can see is that there is an increase in the number of children who are falling in the very low to low ranges for positive emotions, such as feeling happy or joyful. And same with the emotion regulation. So more difficulties with managing frustrations in this sample. Now moving on to the mental health difficulties as measured by the anger, anxiety, depressive symptoms and sleep disturbance subscales of the PROMIS. So what we found was that there's only 1 to 2% of children falling in the very high or severe ranges on the PROMIS. But of concern, there was still 1 in 4 children experiencing moderate levels of anxiety symptoms. In comparison, we found that there was a significant increase in the number of children falling in the very high or severe range on the PROMIS for anxiety. And of particular concern, what I actually did find surprising was that there was an increase in the number of children who were having higher levels of depressive symptoms. So this was things such as low mood, withdrawn, not showing happiness during play. So we're able to look at changes in total scores over time between the two groups, between survey one and survey two. So this is over a 3-month period with the green lines representing children who went through the second lockdown, purple no second lockdown, and the orange line represents the normative levels. And so what we saw that overall, if the groups were combined, there was a slight significant increase in anxiety symptoms. But when we split it into the two groups, we found that there was a significant interaction over time with children who experienced the second lockdown experiencing a significant increase in anger or irritability, such as temper tantrums, anxiety, and depressive symptoms. One thing based on the results we found in survey one was that a lot of people were reporting behaviours that were consistent with what we've defined as attachment seeking behaviour. So this was things like the increased clinginess, the increased need to be very close to the parents, even if they're in their own home, or needing a lot more constant reassurance or affirmations. And so we've created a survey to help track some of these behaviours across the rest of the survey. And what you can see is that children, and then this was measuring whether parents were noticing an increase in these behaviours since the pandemic had started. And you can see that the clinginess and the needing lots of attention and the more emotional outbursts were particularly common and increased in children who experienced the second lockdown. So just a couple of more quotes, because I think it really helps show the impact of the lockdown. So not being able to see our maternal and child health nurse makes it difficult to know if my child is meeting the developmental milestones. If there are issues and these were not identified and interventions were not made in a timely manner, this could have long-lasting negative effects on my child's development. Lockdown is having a negative impact on my kids. Sometimes my daughter, who is three, doesn't want to open the curtains or go outside even for an hour, even for the hour she's allowed to. It makes me so hard and sad, and parenting in lockdown is hard. And finally, he went from being a really creative kid, always exploring and happy to play by himself, to being withdrawn and not able to play alone at all, and getting really anxious if we didn't play with him. It breaks my heart. We tried so hard to minimize our work. For 9 weeks while childcare was closed, I worked until 2 a.m. every night and did a few hours each weekend. So most of the daylight hours I could play with my son. It's been exhausting. So this is not surprisingly, this is having significant impacts on caregivers in terms of the day-to-day lives, and more pronounced for families who went through the second lockdown. Particularly 62% were moderately to very much impacted from needing to work home and look after very young children, and that loss of social support, particularly from not having grandparents or not being able to send to childcare or having support from nannies, for example, or not being able to see friends, which is so important for support during these years. So what we found is that for parents who didn't go through the second lockdown, around 15 to 19% are still falling within the moderate to extremely severe ranges on the depression, anxiety and stress scale. But what we can see is that there has been a significant increase for parents who have gone through that second lockdown, with 27% falling in the moderate to severe ranges for depression, with up to 44% reporting high levels of stress. Again, just reporting the total scores over time, and we can see that for each of the subscales, parents have reported a significant increase between time one and time two of this survey being completed. But just some positives and silver linings to come from the survey. So many families have reported that whilst it has been a stressful time, they really appreciated the increased level of quality time that they have had as a family. There's increased closeness found amongst some of the family members. And I think across the board, an increased gratefulness and appreciation for what they have. So whether it's what the experiences in Australia have been like or what we saw coming through from the second survey, families were extremely grateful if they hadn't had to have that experience of going through a second lockdown. And there was also learning or knowing that their family can cope when faced with a stressful situation. And for nearly 50% of families, they've found that the pandemic has led to increased opportunities that weren't available. So perhaps it's a different job opportunity or new business ideas that have been formed during this time. And again, greater connection or new ways of connecting with friends and family. Many of the open quotes have also reported how great it's been to have the flexibility in working arrangements, or having fathers in particular being able to be more present in the day-to-day living and more involved with the children's lives during this time. So during our first survey, we were interested to find out what kinds of mental health support options would parents of young children prefer to seek out. So what we found was that the most preferred ways, so 93 to 95% said that they'd like to access support by an information or educational website or by attending face-to-face therapy with a health professional. Around 77% said that they would consider accessing therapy over video call. Of interest, we found that it was only about 44% if it was over just telephone rather than the video component. And around 77% would consider using structured online programs with or without therapist support. So I want to, this leads into some of the resources that my team at the Queensland Centre for Perinatal and Infant Mental Health have been working on during this time. So some of you may be familiar with the Birdies Tree website. So this was initially developed to support families of young children who'd experienced natural disasters such as fires and cyclones. However, during the pandemic, we've updated many of these resources to also to be helpful and relevant. So on the main page, families can go to the Birdies Tree games, and on here there's things to help children to talk about or play games related to emotions and to help them process and understand the things they're going through. So for example, we've added some characters in there wearing PPE. And there's a number of Birdie storybooks on here as well. So anyone can go to this website. Probably quickest way is just Google Birdie's Tree. So during the start of the pandemic, led by Andrea Baldwin from our team, Birdie in the Virus was written and adapted from the existing books and has been widely disseminated and is now available in 11 different translations and being shared across the world. So this book is available for free online as a flip book, and there's also an animated version, or it can be ordered at $10 a book through the website. We've also recently released the Birdie's Tree book and animations to help children and caregivers to do deep breathing. It goes through 10 different yoga movements, as well as some progressive muscle relaxation and imagery. We've also used tip sheets for parents and educators. And recently we've just launched a Fun with Birdie activity book to help children going through stressful or disruptive times. So there's a wide range of games and mazes and all sorts of things to help children with feelings and just have fun during a stressful time. So again, this book is freely available on our website. We've also released at the end of last year a trauma animation for any children who have experienced a disruptive event. This can be accessed through this our Queensland Centre for Perinatal and Infant Mental Health resource page. And in terms of one last thing from the survey three, we're just about to analyse these findings. So this was the one completed in November, but we asked what type of mental health supports were families seeking out if they were concerned about how their child was coping. So around 25% have reported accessing information on an educational website. Around 8%, 9% have seen a GP or private psychologist about their concerns. Around 4% have used online therapy and coaching, and 1.2% have accessed support from a psychiatrist. So some take-home messages. So I guess my biggest message is don't forget about the mental health needs of babies, toddlers and preschoolers. And even though we're getting back to some sort of new normal, even the news coming out of Melbourne today, it shows that there's no predictability or consistency still, and things are still very much disrupted. So it's to continue thinking about how might young children be perceiving the events around them and just monitoring for any signs of impact. So whilst the majority are resilient and doing really well, some of the signs to look out for are increased disruptive behaviours, anxieties and worries, and sleeping changes. And being particularly on the lookout for how children in that second lockdown group are going, as they were 2 to 5 times more likely to be showing high to very high levels of mental health difficulties. And parents have also been struggling with the burden of managing everything that they need to over this time. So implications, parents have been doing it tough, reach out, lend a hand, and we really need to increase access to evidence-based resources and support services for their own mental wellbeing, as well as supporting their parenting role. We need to be investing in service development, workforce development in the perinatal and infant mental health across the continuum of care, from the universal mental health promotion to intensive specialised care. We know that early childcare educators are in the perfect position to help identify early signs of children struggling. And we know that parents often would much prefer to receive that information from an early childcare specialist to let them know if they do need further support for their child. And finally, we need to be working in collaboration to provide culturally sensitive and specialised mental health services for children who are most at risk. So from here, it's ongoing collaborations with my colleagues overseas. So all of the countries have recruited at least 500 up to 2,000 participants in each country. So I'm really excited about having this large data set for this age group to explore further over time. So that's all for today. You can access the first two reports on our COVID-19 Unmasked research study. They go into a lot more detail of what I've covered today. And you can access me with any questions at any time on my email address. So thank you. Time for questions.
This is Diana Harris. I'm the General Manager for Projects and Programs here at ERACI. Thank you so much for that presentation. There's a lot of really useful information in there. While we pull up some of the questions that have come through while you've been speaking, I'd like to kick us off with a question about the children who did not go through a second lockdown. So in survey one, you found that about 80% of kids had good mental health. And in survey two, the ones who had not gone through a second lockdown were coming out around 88 to 95% good mental health. So that's implying to me that they're bouncing back. Is that right?
Yes, I think overall, we definitely did see that there was a significant decline in most of the symptoms, and that the majority of children were doing well. And what we sort of predicted to see, given that things were starting to get back to normal and kids were going back to childcare centres and things like that. However, the thing that surprised me, I suppose, was that we found that there was still around 1 in 4 having moderate to high levels of anxiety. I think that was related to some of the ongoing changes, but I'll be really interested to see how this group is going in our 6-month follow-up survey. I expect to see that they will have been returning to more normal levels of functioning, and perhaps the children still experiencing some difficulties may have had some pre-existing difficulties prior to the pandemic, or some other more complicated difficulties such as attachment, parent-child relationship difficulties. So definitely interested to track how that group are going at 6 and 12 months.
Very much so. And for the ones that have been through a second lockdown, you make a very valid point in that we're not out of the woods yet, and no one can predict what's going to happen next and whether we might go into further lockdowns. There's clearly a cumulative effect, not only in the number of lockdowns, but in how long they go on for. So if we do, and let's hope we don't, but if we do have a third lockdown, will you expect to see that downward trajectory for some children continue?
Yeah, I think overall, as you said, it is an ongoing stressor that many people are facing, but we're also starting to get used to some of these changes as well. So I think overall, if those right supports are in place and that there's like limited disruption in terms of what children are doing on the day-to-day basis, that we'll continue to see some of those decreases over time. The hard thing is that there's not a lot of baseline data for this age group, using something like the measure we're using to know how much was already pre-existing. But yeah, overall expecting to see that over time, as the normality continues, that there will be, most children will be doing well.
Fantastic. Now we've got our questions up, and hopefully we've answered one of them already, which was about long-term effects. There's a few people asking about data for families that are sort of less to a broader socioeconomic range, for instance. That's out with your study, it's my understanding, but are you aware of any similar work that's looking to go a bit broader?
So it was one of those things that we had hoped and tried to target our recruitment options across a number of different groups. But as what we're finding here in Australia and many of the other teams so far, that it is biased towards that high SES group. Probably the length of the surveys make it more difficult as well. However, one thing that my team here, as well as some collaborators in Melbourne, we're just about to start data collection using a clinical sample, so children who are attending an infant mental health service, so to look at some of the mental health impacts and experiences they've had over the last 12 months with the pandemic, and also how this may have impacted the level of care that they were able to experience during that time as well. So from that side of thing, we're hoping that those projects will help target a different sample. Other than that, I'm not aware of any in this age group with a more representative focus at the moment.
Now, there's definitely some interest in what's going to happen next and directions that you might take the research as you interrogate the data set. People are curious to know how the second lockdown data in Australia is going to compare with other countries that have experienced months of lockdown. And someone's asking about whether there's going to be any more granular analysis in differences in age ranges, 1 to 2 years, 2 to 3, et cetera.
Yeah, definitely. I'm definitely interested to look more closely at the 1 to 2 year olds and then the 3 to 5 year olds as well. Obviously, we're able to assess some more things in terms of worries and things like that with the older age group, but definitely looking at age effects across our sample. And I'm also really looking forward to comparing the Australian experiences with some of the other countries. And from the sort of the early data that I've seen coming out of the US and Turkey, I've been really surprised to see that there hasn't been as many differences as I thought that there would be. So when we're looking at the indirect impacts in terms of missing out or being impacted by not seeing friends or family or missing out on important activities, there's similar rates of impact across the different countries, and also finding very similar rates of anxiety and depression and behavioural changes as well. So I think it's just an interesting thing because this age group perhaps have less of an understanding of the direct threats caused by the virus, but they're very aware of the changes and disruptions going on at home, the impact it's having on their caregivers, and the relationships going on in the family. So for me, it's going to be really interesting to continue exploring the different countries who've had very different experiences to Australia. But perhaps whilst the threat of the virus hasn't been as high or the rates haven't been as high, some of the restrictions may have been different. So definitely looking forward to some further closer analysis over time. We're actually just about to also start looking with our 3 to 4 different time points, looking at what are the trajectories and which children seem to be more on that high continual level, which children's are sort of spiked in mental health difficulties but returning to normal, and what are the risk and protective factors for those different groups. So they'll be sort of the new things we're looking at over the next few months.
Sure. Just to clarify for the folk who are asking, yes, Alex's presentation will be available on the website with the recording of this webinar. Alex, a practical question from Olga, which is, what can childcare centres and early educators do to support families and children?
Yeah, I think that's a really great question, and so much that they can do. So part of the work that my group associated with Birdie's Tree at the Queensland Centre for Perinatal Infant Mental Health, they've developed an early childcare training curriculum which they have delivered in 16 different childcare centres following bushfires and floods. And what they found, whilst it was targeting or promotion and mental health promotion and things like that, there's many of the principles that are suitable and helpful for the COVID pandemic as well. But basically, one of the things that we found Child Care Centres have really helped is reading the storybooks, so such as Birdie and the Virus. It's a really good way to help children to process and understand some of the strange things going on around them, and gives the opportunities to correct any misunderstandings they may be having. So what we find is that parents and caregivers and educators often avoid talking about stressful things, as often assume that they won't understand or they don't need to know this information. But we know that even babies and very young children are very perceptive of what's going on around them. So early childcare educators can do a great job with reading the storybooks. There's also puppets and soft toys that go along with Birdie and Mr. Frog, which is a good way of playing and processing these events. And I think really just looking out for signs of anxiety and distress or behavioural disturbances to then be able to flag that with parents and supporting them to access further supports if educators are.
Thanks, Alex. There's a lot of love for Birdie and the Birdie Tree, Birdie's Tree website coming up on the comments. And a lot of appreciation for this important work that you're doing and for presenting it today. So just before we wrap up, I think there's one more question, which is that will we be seeing Birdie gets the vaccine in the next wee while?
That's a very good point. That well, actually, there is, now that reminds me, we had written a previous book around more epidemics. It was before the pandemic had started, and in that book, I think it's Birdie and the Big Sickness, and Birdie does get a vaccine in that book, but we updated it when the pandemic started because there was no vaccines available. So I guess that storybook would actually be helpful. It talks about things that Birdie does when having the needle, such as blowing bubbles to help distract them. So so yeah, I guess that one could actually be adapted and used for that context. So yeah.
Thank you.
Thanks, Alex. Thanks again for joining us today. A recording of this webinar alongside the slides will be made available later this week on the website. Keep an eye on our weekly newsletter for details, as well as other webinars. Thanks again, Alex, and to everyone who attended today. And thanks and goodbye.
Thanks, everyone. Bye.